Hello, what a blessed day we've had already here on campus at Bible Baptist Church. You see, pastors reopened. That's right. We're ready for you. Bible Baptist Church, come back home. Now, we're doing this in phases. The first phase is a 9 o'clock preaching service. That's for folks that are 65 years and older. And remember, there's no childcare during that time. However, we have an 11 o'clock service. It's for all ages to include childcare. Now, we're ready for you. It's safe. Please come back home. Now, during this reopening, we still will be having our weekly online Zoom Bible studies. The women, they meet at 7 o'clock with Miss Kelly Counts on Fridays. And then the men, we're meeting on Tuesdays and on Saturdays. Tuesdays at 7:15, and then on Saturdays at 9:30 with Pastor Counts. And us teens, we meet on Tuesday nights for a fun game night at 5 p.m. And then we meet on Thursday nights at 5 for our Bible study. Please log on to our Facebook and see how each and every one of our family members and yours too can be involved. Now, we ask you to mark your calendars. June 21st is coming up very fast. That's Father's Day. It's going to be a fantastic day here at Bible Baptist Church. Pastors lined out a whole bunch of events. We have a community-wide blood drive. We're going to have a gigantic barbecue for all the families and fathers that stay and participate. It's going to be a great day here at Bible Baptist Church, June 21st for Father's Day. Now, Pastor wanted to thank each and every one of us for being faithful with our tithe. And he asked us, if there's anything that you would need, please call the office and just reach out, and one of us will get back to you to help. That's all of the announcements that we have. Please, have a great week.
For the great I am. On Friday, across America, the average cost of a gallon of milk was how much? What would you say? Well, it was $3.36 across America. What was the cost in 1960? Some of you will remember this. In 1960, a gallon of milk was 49 cents. Now, in America, if it were, and it's not this time, I'm just putting a time down, if we would say that it's 6:05, either a.m. or p.m., if it's 6:05, someone in Great Britain would likely say that it's 6:05. They would say it backwards from us. Now, I have another question for you. What was the most sold vehicle in America in 1979, the 40 years ago recorded? How many were sold, or what was the number one vehicle sold in America? It was the Oldsmobile Cutlass. In 2019, and has been for a while, the most sold vehicle was the Ford F-Series pickup truck. Now, there's one thing about that little comparison right there. If you didn't come of age, but just recently, you looked at somebody right now and said, "What's an Oldsmobile?" They're not even around anymore. Things change. That's what we're talking about. There are differences. But while we see that everywhere we go, that there are differences here, differences there, differences from the past to the present, differences of thinking, I want us to focus on that which has not changed. Would you think with me about that today and maybe for the next several weeks, some things that have not changed? Take your Bible with me and go to the book of Acts, chapter number 1. Acts, chapter number 1. When you find this great chapter, I want you to look down at verse number 9. Acts, chapter number 1, and we'll begin reading in verse number 9. But today, there are really three words that I want you to remember. If you remember these three words, and we're going to expound on them some, but if you remember these three words, you've really got the message, and it's going to give you some drive, some pickup for the coming days. Acts chapter number 1 and verse number 9, the Bible there says, "And when he had spoken these things," he, of course, is Jesus. He's just given here in Acts a form of that great commission, "You shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me." When he had spoken these things, verse number 9, "While they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel." Verse number 11. "Which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey." Remember those three words from the Bible today. This same Jesus. Father, I pray that your blessing would be upon this message. For these, Father, watching online, for those who will be here in person, in the various formats, even those who would drive up and listen on the FM station if that's what they would choose to do. So many different formats and different ways than we've had before. But Father, today as we focus on that which has not changed, we begin with the one who is the same yesterday and today and forever. And may that be our focus. May we grow through it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we look at differences, let's look at that which has not changed. And remember what I prayed. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. The Bible says in Malachi, "I am the Lord, I change not." Car companies like an Oldsmobile, they may come and they will go, but Jesus remains the same. A milk price may go up or it may go down, or it's more likely to just go up and up and up, but Jesus is the same. Things in our world will change, but Jesus is the same. I put out on Facebook the other day, our world is hurting. We need to pray for America. Our nation is hurting. But remember something, the answer is Christ. Though an economy is important, there's of course the need for it. The answer is not economy. The answer is Christ. Though there's a political side to everything, and it seems every day that gets more and more divisive and more hurtful, Good people can hardly today seem to even talk to each other if they fall on different lines politically. Politics come and politics go. Politicians come and politicians go. But Jesus remains the same, and Christ is the answer. So I want us to focus on those words today. This same Jesus. And there are really four motivations or encouragements that we have from the Word of God right here in the Bible regarding those three wonderful words. I want you to consider with me why he said, or why the angels said this to these men. Now, picture the scene with me, if you will. Jesus has just given his very last earthly instructions to his men, to his disciples. And as he's given them these instructions, he goes up, and what do? They watch, and they watch, and they watch, and they watch until he's gone out of their sight. What did they do when he was gone from their sight? Well, they kept watching. They look up, and these angels came and said, "You men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing?" There's a reason why they said that. Number one, would you look at this? This same Jesus is our motivation to follow him. Our motivation to follow him. In verse 11, that question, "Why stand ye here gazing up into heaven?" The question points these men to a direction. In the Bible, questions are very important. God doesn't put questions in just for a reason, for any reason. God puts them there for a specific reason, and it was there for these men that day. The question has a direction from the angels that was given from, and it's this. These disciples are being called out. They're being called out to do what they know to do. We today are being called out. Why stand ye gazing? And we can gaze on several different things. We can gaze on our problems. Oh, we're good at that. We gaze on the issue, the problem that we have of the day, or the problems we have in the nation, or the problems we have with this illness, this virus that is out there. We can look at problems all day. We can gaze on disagreements. And I want to challenge every member and every person involved with the Bible Baptist Church family. We can have differences in this, and that's okay. This is the type of thing that we don't separate over. It ought to bring us together. I see all the commercials in America. We're in this together. Well, they can say that in the commercial, but nowhere else should it be more apparent than in the local church that we as a church family are together. Whatever side we are to fall upon, we can have a disagreement, but I like the old statement, we can disagree agreeably. There's not room in situations like this for us to disagree and to be ugly about it. There are people who fall on every range of the spectrum when it comes to this virus, the response to it, being in a quarantine, coming out of a quarantine, disagreements. We can gaze on that. We can gaze on disappointments, the hurts of our life. Some of you, your concern really isn't what's going on with this particular virus right now. Your concern in your life is a past. Perhaps it's regret, decisions that you've made. And you tend in your life to gaze on those disagreements. Or maybe it's what somebody did to you. A hurt that is there from your past. And you struggle with that. You hurt with that day by day by day by day. You think about that person who hurt you. You think about that choice that you made. And those are disappointments from your past. God didn't call us to gaze on our problems all day. You know what gazing on our problems all day leads to? It leads to worry. You know what gazing on our disagreements causes us to do? It causes hurt. Do you know what gazing upon our disappointments calls us to do? If we just gaze on disappointment, it leads to regret. God wants his people to be forward-minded. And so these disciples here are being called out. You men of Galilee, why stand you here gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, watch this in the verse, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Means this same Jesus is coming back. Not an imposter, not a new one, not a different one. This same Jesus is coming back. Now you have been left here to do what you know to do, disciples. And whether that's Peter and James and John, or that's the disciple that sits here and here and there, we are called to do what we know to do. What is a disciple? A disciple is called to be, and this is actually the word, a disciple is a learner, one who learns from another. And that comes true in every different aspect of life. We get a chuckle around here about all the changes that have happened around the church and how we operate. The church itself hasn't changed, but how we operate has changed somewhat. And we've gotten pretty good at hearing news and then, okay, we got to make that change and we'll do it. Then what do? We try to learn. We watch things. We listen to people. We talk to people so that we can learn. But let me ask you this. If a disciple is a learner, what is the purpose of his learning? The purpose of his learning is this: you learn and then you follow what you taught. So there's a learner and then there is a follower. Now, what does a follower do? A follower, let me illustrate it this way. I like the sunlight. I have to be careful of it, but I like the sunlight. I'm the crazy person that to me, the hotter the better. I'm the odd duck that when it's hot outside, I've been known to drive down the road without my air conditioner on, and I roll down the windows because I like the feel of that warm air on my skin. I may not do it for long, but I like the feel of that. I don't mind waiting outside for things. Doesn't bother me. I have to take that in consideration when it comes to other people at church. I don't mind that all that much. I like the sun. I like to hang out in the sun, S-U-N. Here's what we need. We need people who enjoy hanging out, so to speak, or being with, or spending time with the S-O-N, Jesus Christ. And a follower is a learner who follows in the steps of Jesus Christ. But not only does he want us to follow in his steps, he has called us to be a doer. A disciple, three words sum up a disciple. A disciple is a learner, a disciple is a follower, and a disciple is a doer. I haven't really learned, and I haven't really followed my teacher if I haven't learned to do what I have been called to do. So instead of gazing on my problems, my disagreements, my disappointments, I learn to learn after him, to follow after him, and to do what he has called us to do. But I want to ask you this, why are we spending time on our problems, on our worries, on our discouragements? Why are we spending our time on that and not spending our time on this? Go forward doing what God has called us to do. It is not time for Christians to sit still and let the world go by. It is time for Christians to stand. It is not time for Christians to sit idly by and just sit on the dock of the bay wasting time, as the old song would say. It is time for the people of God to still be a witness for Christ. We're not going to focus on it today, but Acts chapter 1 and verse number 8 still applies today. We are witnesses, and we are called to do, to go forward. So our first motivation is the motivation to follow him. This same Jesus also gives us a motivation to look for the upward calling. Would you notice a word that's used over and over and over in this passage? One is the word up. And secondly is this word. Look at it now. The middle of verse number 11. It says, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. We're to have a heavenly mindset and to think of this same Jesus who came, lived, died, rose again, went back up into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go. This same Jesus. Now, everything connects. Everything in my life connects. You ever play that old game Scrabble? In my parents' home, they have a Scrabble board that's been framed. Somebody made it for them with every child and grandchild in the family. And we've looked at that board, and some of us looked at it and said, if we ever have other children, they only connect off of certain letters. We have to name them certain. We've had fun looking at that at get-togethers. But they have a Scrabble board where every name connects. I like that when it comes to family. But how much more when it comes to the Christian life, that everything in my life ought to connect to heaven? The decisions that I make ought to be made because this same Jesus who went back up into heaven will come again. But sadly, we as Christians, we hear that so often that it just goes in one ear and far too often out the other. If there's ever a time that we ought to say what we do has eternal responsibility and eternal reward. It is to live our lives as though Jesus would come at any moment. Do you believe it? Do you live by it? This same Jesus will come again. I live my life connecting dot to dot to dot that Jesus will come again. Number three, this same Jesus, it is our encouragement. And oh, this is important. It is our encouragement or our motivation against anxiety. If Jesus hasn't changed God's people, why do we worry and fret as we do? The one who saw every believer through every, doesn't mean they didn't have problems. We have problems. I have struggles. You have problems. Every one of God's children will have problems and struggles. But it's the cure of anxiety. Think about the difference in these men. Jesus has died. And he's in the grave. And these men were hidden out like cowards, waiting because they thought their time was coming next. But then something happened. They saw Jesus Christ the Lord in his glorified body, resurrected, and it changed their lives. And then they saw something else, and it changed their lives. That Jesus, the same Jesus who came and died, rose again. But then when he went back up into heaven, those angels looked at them and say, why do you stand here gazing up into heaven? Why are you looking for him now? He's going to come again, but he's called you to a responsibility. And there became a difference in these men. They were changed. Nothing, nothing, nothing ought to separate us from our walk in Christ. That word disciple, the word disciple is a Greek word. And it comes from the Greek language, and it really has to do with this. Discipleship in Greek philosophy was a big deal. Plato, Aristotle, you kind of know that some of the names and some of the differences, and one would teach the other. That infiltrated the whole world. Greece was the stronghold, the capital, the world power at one time, but eventually they lost out to another empire, the Roman Empire. And when the Romans came in and conquered, boy, when they conquered, they took it. And this land after this land and this land. But the Greek culture was so embedded into that Roman world that even though the Romans had conquered, they had work that they had to do in much of the world because the Greek culture was so strong, they made disciples of Greek culture everywhere that they went. And that's the word disciple there that was used, is that those Greeks infiltrated. Listen now, they didn't become like what was most important in the world. They went out and they changed the world around them. How much like that ought to be the disciples of Jesus Christ? That we as God's people, instead of being anxious and filled with worry and concern. Listen, God's children, the Bible didn't change. God has not given us the spirit of fear. Do we have a spirit of wisdom? Yes. Ought we to be cautious? Yes. But God has not given us a spirit of fear, to cower in some corner, to be fearful, but of power and of love and of a sound mind for all of us. And that example of the Greek culture, though conquered, and the Roman world in control, the Greeks still went and with the culture infiltrated, discipled. We as believers ought to have that same mentality in a world that does not love God. And don't ever fool yourself. This world doesn't love God. But we are called to make a difference in the world. And these disciples would go and they turn the world upside down by Acts chapter number 17. They say they that have turned the world upside down have come here also. I speak to many today over the power of technology, and in the service here this morning, they may see the cameras and the differences in the technology. And if you're here, you've already seen it. What an opportunity. Social media doesn't have to be a bad thing, it's an opportunity. Video doesn't have to be a bad thing, it's an opportunity. Radio doesn't have to be a bad thing, it's an opportunity for God's people to make a difference by the power of God. But when is that going to happen? When we as God's people get a glimpse of this same Jesus. It's powerful, it's life-changing. But then number four is it was a motivation, those words, this same Jesus, a motivation for unity. Look with me, if you will. Verse number 13 says, and when they were come in, they went up into an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. Now, there's so much there in those names. Sometimes we think, because we've heard so much about fishermen, that we think all of Jesus' disciples were fishers. Several of them were, but not all of them. Did you know, before they knew Christ, some of these disciples would have despised each other. They would have seen each other about, and many of these fishermen, they would have wanted nothing to do with somebody like Matthew. Matthew would have been a turncoat to them. Matthew would have been a cheat. See that name Simon? He's Simon the Zealot. Before he came to Christ, he was for the forceful overthrow of the Roman Empire by Jews. And before he met Christ, that's why he's known as the Zealot. That's what they wanted. He would have, Matthew again, he would have despised somebody like Matthew. Matthew worked for the Roman government. But all the difference came in Christ when they spent time with him, when they watched him, when they saw his resurrection, they saw him ascend. There was a change in these men, and God took separate men and separate people, his mother, the disciples, the other followers, about 120 were up there, and he brought them and he unified them together. I have used this illustration for years, and others have. On either side of me on the platform, those in person today would have seen them. But on either side of me, there are pianos that are out there, and they play. And one will play something, and another will play another thing, but together, they don't play in unison. That's not what they're meant to do, and that's not what the pianists are meant to do. They're meant to play in unity, creating harmony and bringing out the melody and adding things that just pour in on top of the music and make it more beautiful than it was before. I think of the great pianist we have around our church. They don't get up and they don't play. You see a duet. You see my wife and Cora, they would get up and they play on the same piano. They don't play the same thing, but it works together in unity to create beautiful music. God takes different people with different thoughts and different ways, and in his power, he unites them as we look at this same Jesus. Today is the day that we as Christians can see all the differences that are out there. That's simple to do. All you have to do is turn on your television or turn on the radio or look at your news feed on your phone, and you'll see all the differences that are out there in the world today. What we need to focus on is that which never changes. And I remind all of you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, Jesus never, ever changes, this same Jesus. But for those of you that are watching and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, the same Jesus who died on that cross, who rose again, who ascended up to the Lord, that same Jesus died for you. That same Jesus who loves me loves you. That same Jesus who gave everything that believers might have everything, not of our own goodness, but by his grace, that same Jesus lives for you today. And if you would call upon him in forgiveness of your sins, the Lord will save you today. He died for you. He loved you. He's the same one, the everlasting one. The Bible calls him the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. If you would come to him, the Bible says he will in no wise cast you out, and he will save you like he saved these men, and he saved me, and he loves you as well. And you would pray, "Dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner, and if I were to die without you, I know that I would not go to heaven, I would go to hell. But God, Christ died for me, the same Jesus, to forgive me of my sins." And if you would seek forgiveness and say, "Lord, I call upon you today to forgive me of my sins, to cleanse me, make me ready for heaven," that same Lord will save you, that saved me, that saved these others, if you call on him today. God's people, it's not time to be separated by all the differences. It's time to be united under the banner of what doesn't change. And the first one I want to give to you is this same Jesus. He has called us together. He is our strength. He is our purpose. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. He is coming again. And like the angel said to the disciples, we need to say to ourselves today, "Why stand ye gazing up into heaven?" This same Jesus. Stop looking around and look to the Lord and follow him. Our Father, I come to you right now and I ask for your blessing upon this message. Father, really just three words that we expanded upon today, but three words to focus on in a world filled with hurt and change and difference, that which doesn't change, this same Jesus. I pray for those who would watch online, those that would be here in person that do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, that today they would come to know the Lord and get it settled eternally. For Christians, that we would be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. In Jesus' name, amen. May the Lord bless each of you, and we'll see you back online Sunday night, Wednesday night. Stay online for a little while as we make adjustments and we return to normal, but we do it wisely and we do it safely. So be back in your place tonight, Sunday night at 6 o'clock for another great service. May the Lord bless you.